The Uluru Statement from the Heart is a message written to the Australian people from Indigenous Australians. It is the culmination of more than a decade's work and the largest deliberative process with Indigenous people on Australia's constitution in our nation's history. 13 meetings were held across the country with a final national convention involving hundreds of delegates at our nation's physical and spiritual heart, Uluru. Almost 300 people put their signature to this historic statement. The senior boss ladies of Uluru then painted the dreamings of that place around the statement to express the ancient connection with our law and our land. The three themes of the statement are voice, treaty, and truth. To understand where these themes have come from, we must look back into the past. For thousands of years, the continent was occupied by its Indigenous people, who had their own laws, leadership, and territories. In 1770, Cook claimed the east coast of Australia, and shortly after, all of the inhabitants were proclaimed as British subjects. Without their knowledge or agreement, they had come under the rule of British law and government. As Aboriginal land was claimed, the first people faced extreme hardship and great upheaval. Many Aboriginal people fought back. Others tried different means of finding a voice in the new world. In 1881, the Yorta Yorta petitioned the Governor of New South Wales. They say, "All the land within our tribal boundaries has been taken possession of by the government and white settlers, rendering our means of subsistence extremely precarious and often reducing us and our wives and children to beggary." William Barak writes from Corranderk, a small parcel of land in Victoria which was all they had been left from their vast Wurundjeri territories. He says, "We should be free like the white population. There is only a few blacks now remaining in Victoria, and we blacks of Aboriginal blood wish to have now freedom for all our lifetime." These are just a few of the many thousands of letters and petitions that fell on deaf ears. In 1901, mass celebrations take place in Sydney to celebrate the formation of the states into one federated government under the new Australian Constitution. Yet the Constitution failed to recognise Indigenous people. It specifically excluded Indigenous people from being counted in the census. Further, it didn't allow the new Commonwealth government the power to make laws about Indigenous people. The first people are effectively locked out of a new Australian democracy, and 1 year later, a law is passed to ban all Aboriginal people from voting in federal elections.
It quite amuses me to hear the people saying, "I don't like the black man." But he's damn glad to live in a black man's country all the same. I'm calling the Corroboree of all the natives of New South Wales to send a petition to the King in an endeavour to improve our condition. All the black man wants is representation in federal parliament.
He was not the only voice. In 1933, Yorta Yorta man William Cooper prepared a petition also calling for representation in parliament. It took years to gather almost 200 signatures and was signed by our people from across the nation. It said, "The original occupants and we, their heirs and successors, should be adequately cared for. Our lands have been expropriated by Your Majesty's government. Legal status is denied to us by Your Majesty's government in the Commonwealth. Your petitioners therefore humbly pray that Your Majesty will intervene on our behalf and grant to our people representation in the federal parliament." The Victorian government decided that no good purpose would be had by sending it to the King. The petition was lost and the request left unanswered. By the 1960s, emancipation of black people was sweeping through Africa and America. Meanwhile, our people were isolated in reserves and missions as wards of the state. Our children were being removed in their thousands. Our young men and women were being exploited for their labour, and legislation entrenched segregation against us as law. The demands of our people for rights to land, equality, and recognition as the first people and a voice to government were building momentum. It was about to become a national movement. The 1960s began with the formation of the Federal Council for the Advancement of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islanders, FACATSI, which incorporated advancement groups in a number of states. Campaigns included equal wages, a referendum to change the Australian Constitution, and land rights. After a 10-year campaign to change the Constitution, involving people from all walks of life, the 1967 referendum was held. It was the most successful referendum in Australian history. Overwhelmingly, Australians voted for the Commonwealth to have the power to make laws for Indigenous people. Overwhelmingly, Australians voted for the Commonwealth to have the power to make laws for our people, doing away with racist legislation in the states. We were also to be counted in the national census. It was a moment of triumph and unity. In 1967, we were counted. Now we seek to be heard. So the Constitution now allows the government to make laws specifically about Indigenous people. And now we want the right to have a say about those laws, like the Native Title Act and other special Indigenous laws. The voice would give advice from Indigenous people to Parliament, not a veto, not another chamber of Parliament, just advice from people who are affected by the laws that are made about them. It needs to be built into the Constitution so it cannot be removed by the whim of government, only by the Australian people. Secret instructions to Lieutenant James Cook, 1769. You are, with the consent of the natives, to take possession of convenient situations in the country in the name of the King of Great Britain. No such consent was sought or given. In 1835, John Batman thought he had negotiated the first treaty for access to over 2,000 hectares of land of the Kulin people. However, the governor proclaimed, "It has been represented to me that His Majesty's subjects have taken possession of vacant lands of the Crown under the pretense of a treaty with the Aboriginal natives. I notify all His Majesty's subjects that every such treaty and contract with the Aboriginal natives is void and of no effect against the rights of the Crown." In effect, what the governor said was that British law ruled, and to recognise Aboriginal people as landowners under their own law would undermine the rule and sovereignty of the Crown. For the next 150 years, this remained the status quo, despite significant opposition and protest. The word Makarrata was embraced in 1977 by the National Aboriginal Conference. A word from the Yolngu Mata language, they explain that Makarrata makes it clear this is intended to be an agreement within Australia between Australians. The Yolngu concept of Makarrata captures the idea of two parties coming together after a struggle, healing the divisions of the past. It is about acknowledging that something has been done wrong and it needs to be made right. By 1988, the anniversary of 200 years of European occupation, known as the Bicentennial Celebrations, the notion of a national treaty had gathered real momentum. People from across the country packed their bags to make the long journey to Sydney, with the bicentennial rapidly approaching. In Tasmania, people fly the flag with pride, and in the streets of Sydney, 40,000 people gather, the largest protest since the Vietnam War. Hope is high that after 200 years, a treaty will be delivered that deals with our unfinished business. Galarrwuy Yunupingu presents the Burunga Statement to the then Prime Minister Bob Hawke. It says, "We, the traditional owners and occupiers of Australia, call on the Australian government and people to recognise our rights to self-determination and self-management, including the freedom to pursue our own economic, social, religious and cultural development, to permanent control and enjoyment of our ancestral lands, to respect for and promotion of our Aboriginal identity, including the cultural, linguistic, religious and historical aspects, and including the right to be educated in our own languages and in our own culture and history. We call on the Commonwealth to pass laws providing a national elected Aboriginal and Islander organisation to oversee Aboriginal and Islander affairs, a national system of land rights, and we call on the Commonwealth Parliament to negotiate with us a treaty recognising our prior ownership, continued occupation and sovereignty, and affirming our human rights and freedom. Hawke makes a promise to negotiate a treaty by 1990. Instead, he creates a reconciliation process to conclude within 10 years. 25 years later, there has been no conclusion to reconciliation. In his last act as Prime Minister, he hangs the Barunga Statement in Parliament House and weeps with regret. After a 10-year legal process, in 1992, the High Court overturns the historical injustice that Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islanders had no rights to land. The Mabo case concludes that Indigenous peoples' title to land existed before Cook and continues to this day. It is a watershed moment. Whilst Mabo dealt with issues around land, it did not deal with other issues of social justice and relationships. In the year 2000, hundreds of thousands of Australians walk across the bridge in the name of reconciliation. After a 10-year process, the Australian Declaration of Reconciliation is presented to the then Prime Minister John Howard with great ceremony at the Sydney Opera House. It proposes that each government and parliament recognise that this land and its waters were settled as colonies without treaty or consent, and that to advance reconciliation, it would be most desirable if there were agreements or treaties through which unresolved issues of reconciliation can be resolved. Howard rejects the statement and the structural reform it proposes. Similar countries to Australia, like the US, Canada, and New Zealand, all have treaties with their Indigenous people. Australia remains the exception. 2020 marks the 200th anniversary of Cook's possession of the continent. The Cook anniversary and the Uluru Statement provide the nation an opportunity to consider the future relationships of the nation with its Indigenous people, and if Makarrata is possible. The Uluru Statement suggests a process of truth-telling is central to resolving the relationship between Indigenous people and the nation. For example, whilst Australia memorialises the history of the Anzacs, it does not acknowledge the well-documented land wars as part of Australia's history. This process of forgetting our history has come to be known as the Great Australian Silence. In the 1820s, Tasmania was the site of some of the most intense warfare in Australia. In 1846, Tasmanian Aboriginal people, who had been exiled at the conclusion of what was called the Black War, petitioned the Queen in relation to the promises made to them that had been broken. They said, "Your Majesty's petitioners are your free children, that we were not taken prisoners but freely gave up our country to Colonel Arthur, then the Governor, after defending ourselves. Your petitioners humbly state to Your Majesty that Mr. Robinson made for us and with Colonel Arthur an agreement which we have not lost from our minds since, and we have made our part of it good." In Queensland, it is estimated that at least 20,000 Aboriginal people lost their lives in the establishment of the state. The Waitangi Treaty and the New Zealand Waitangi Tribunal provides a model for a process of truth-telling for each iwi or tribe. As the Yolngu leader Galarrwuy Yunupingu stated in relation to Makarrata and truth-telling, "The Australian people know that their success is built on the taking of the land, in making the country their own, which they did at the expense of so many languages and ceremonies and songlines and people, now destroyed. They worry about what has been done for them and on their behalf, and they know that reconciliation requires much more than just words. So the task remains, to reconcile with the truth, to find the unity and achieve the settlement. We, gathered at the 2017 National Constitutional Convention, coming from all points of the southern sky, make this statement from the heart. Our Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander tribes were the first sovereign nations of the Australian continent and its adjacent islands, and possessed it under our own laws and customs. This our ancestors did, according to the reckoning of our culture, from the creation, according to the common law, from time immemorial, and according to science more than 60,000 years ago. This sovereignty is a spiritual notion, the ancient tie between the land, or Mother Nature, and the Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples who were born therefrom, remain attached thereto, and must one day return thither to be united with our ancestors. This link is the basis of the ownership of the soil, or better, of sovereignty. It has never been ceded or extinguished, and coexists with the sovereignty of the Crown. How could it be otherwise, that peoples possessed a land for 60 millennia and this sacred link disappears from world history in merely the last 200 years? With substantive constitutional change and structural reform, we believe this ancient sovereignty can shine through as a fuller expression of Australia's nationhood. Proportionally, we are the most incarcerated people on the planet. We are not an innately criminal people. Our children are alien from their families at unprecedented rates. This cannot be because we have no love for them. And our youth languish in detention in obscene numbers. They should be our hope for the future. These dimensions of our crisis tell plainly the structural nature of our problem. This is the torment of our powerlessness. We seek constitutional reforms to empower our people and take a rightful place in our own country. When we have power over our destiny, our children will flourish. They will walk in two worlds and their culture will be a gift to their country. We call for the establishment of a First Nations voice enshrined in the Constitution. Makarrata is the culmination of our agenda, the coming together after a struggle. It captures our aspirations for a fair and truthful relationship with the people of Australia and a better future for our children, based on justice and self-determination. We seek a Makarrata Commission to supervise a process of agreement making between governments and First Nations and truth-telling about our history. In 1967 we were counted. In 2017 we seek to be heard. We leave base camp and start our trek across this vast country. We invite you to walk with us in a movement of the Australian people for a better future.